comes a grace when the heart is under fire. Another way when the walls are closing in. And when I look at the space between where I used to be and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. There was another in the fire, standing next to me. There was another in the waters, holding back the seas. And should I ever need reminding of how I've been set free, there is a cross that bears the burden where another. Oh, my dead, left for dead beneath the water. I'm no longer a slave to my sin anymore. And should I fall in the space between what remains of me?
You're the fire in my soul. staring down a giant. Right now I can't see past my pain. Right now my songs have turned to silence. Good morning. If you're awake, say praise the Lord. If you're asleep, say wake me up. So a pre-warning. I'm going to invite the guys to come up and kneel with me in prayer in a few moments after we read scripture. And when I do that, I understand that we have varying abilities to kneel. Did I hear an amen? We have varying abilities to kneel, and when I say kneel, that means come sit on the front pew. But I want us to get, as a matter of fact, not just the guys, but because of our size, just who's here this morning, let's just all gather down here and pray. So I'll call you in just a minute. Pre-warning: if you take your Bible and open it to Psalms chapter 8. Or Psalm 8. They're not really chapters. Psalm 8. We're going to read Psalm 8 and all the way down into verse 2 of Psalm 9. And I've had a great time with this passage. My prayer is that you would hear it as we begin in worship today and connect it with some of the things that are going to happen in worship today. We're going to sing these words. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. I'm trying not to sing him right now. Yeah, I can hear it. Can you guys hear it? Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Highest praises, honor, and glory be unto your name. Be unto your name. We're going to sing that. And we could just sing it as words. Or we could hear those words and mean them with all of our heart and actually give glory and honor and praise to his name. And so if you found Psalm 8, I want to put that into some context. Stand with me in honor of the reading of God's word. You'll find words similar to these in your translation. O Lord our God, how majestic is your name in all the earth, who have displayed your splendor above the heavens. From the mouth of infants and nursing babes, you have established strength because of your adversaries to make the enemy and the revengeful cease. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have ordained, what is man that you take thought of him, and the son of man that you care for him? Yet you have made him a little lower than God. And you crown him with glory and majesty. You make him to rule over the works of your hands. You have put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, and all the beasts of the field, the birds of the heaven, and the fish of the sea, whatever passes through the paths of the seas. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. I will give thanks to the Lord with all my heart. I will tell of all your wonders. I will be glad and exult in you. I will sing praise to your name, O Most High. May God bless the reading of his word. I want to invite you just to come down, and I'm going to explain my prayer. And while we gather here, I'm going to kneel with you before we start to pray. Anybody who can, if you can't, you can stay right where you are. But I encourage you to come and kneel. Sometimes I write down my prayers so that I pray well. And I pray correctly. And I've written down this prayer. I pray it with all my heart. I encourage you to pray along with me. Almighty God, Father, Jesus, Holy Spirit, our one God, we pray to you this morning. And open our hearts to your presence, to your influence, to your power, and to your will. We come to worship you. Your name is mighty and powerful and magnificent. It is stunning and awe-inspiring. It causes us to stop, to pause. It is holy and powerful. Your name unlocks the answers to our prayers. Your name is precious. You punish those who take your name in vain. We marvel at your name. It stirs our soul as if our very being hears the name of its creator. We gather today to glorify your name, to praise your name, to rejoice and exult in your name. We come to sing of your name. We will boast in your name. We will tell of your name. We have been baptized in your name. We have been justified in your name. We anoint the sick with oil in your name. We call upon your name, and we are saved from perishing. For your name alone is exalted. There is no other name in all the heavens by which men can be saved. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. We magnify your name, O Lord. We worship you in the name of Jesus. Say that name with me. Jesus. Say that name again. Jesus. In the name of the Lord. Amen. Amen. Team, lead us as we head back to our seats.
Thank you.
You guys can be seated for a few moments. I've asked Rick if he would come up, Rick Hall, if he'd come up and lead us in prayer for needs in our congregation. There are definitely needs in our congregation to pray for our search team, to give us a little update on what's happening, and to pray over our offering. I want you to remember to be faithful to your giving. While we're not passing an offering plate anymore, we have the basket in the back. And remember, your gift is to the Lord through the church, not just to the church. Always remember that. We give to Him. So Rick, come and give us a report and lead us.
Well, our pastor search committee, I think, is doing a good job. Last time he asked me to let you know who is on the committee, we have Jack, we have Perry, Tracy, Steve, Jerome, Ray Cope, and myself. When you see these people, you may want to thank them. It's quite a bit of work. It's a lot more work than what I thought it was going to be. Being a principal or an assistant principal, you know, you send out the feelers and everything else, and all the paperwork's done already. Well, here, we're having to come up with, we're working through the job description. That is done. We had to work through the financial package. That's coming along quite well. And we have quite a few applicants. And then we had to update the policies and procedures. Now, that takes a lot of work. So when you see these people, thank them for being on that committee. Please give us your prayers. We definitely need your prayers. Because when you're looking through applications, it's not like, you know, a teacher or something like that. You're looking at spiritual growth of our church. And a lot of times people can say a lot of things, but you're trying to read between the lines. And that's where God gives us discernment. And that's where prayers come in. So I just want to thank you for that. Why don't we pray for the offering? If you can bow your heads, and we'll pray for our offering. Dear Lord, we come to you right now, thanking Lord for who you are. Lord, we thank you for dying on the cross. We thank you for healing. Lord, you made us. You made us in your own image. And Lord, you do things for us that we can't even see. You know every hair on our heads. That only comes from you. Lord, I pray that we can make you Lord of all, Lord of our finances, Lord of our lives. You're the person we come to when our kids are hurting. I thank you for dying on the cross. Thank you for allowing us to be here. Thanking you to allow us to say we're Christians, that we know you. We believe you died on the cross, you rose again. And for this, we do thank you. I want to thank you again. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. I've invited Tracy to come up and introduce our Mission New Mexico video for this morning.
Good morning, church. I want to remind you all that we have our fall festival coming up a week and a day from today, Monday, October 31st. That's here at First Baptist Church, 2112 College Drive. This is a free event for our community. We're going to have a live band. So we want to remind you all that that's coming up in a week. So this month, we're asking our church to give towards the Mission New Mexico State Missions offering. The offering is an above the tithe offering beyond our regular giving. To give towards the offering, use an envelope or give online and specify your gift, Mission New Mexico or State Missions Offering. Through the Mission New Mexico State Missions Offering, New Mexico Baptists are planting churches and partnering with foundations of Ferry Faith Dairy Ministry and the Tri-Area Baptist Association to reach Spanish-speaking Hispanic people with the gospel. Foundations of Faith targets dairy workers because of their unique culture and working conditions. Staff missionaries take the gospel to the dairies and build relationships. They also work to start churches among the areas of the Hispanic people. Listen as Foundation of Faith missionaries tells their own story about reaching people and the number of dairies they are reaching. Through our giving to this offering, we become part of this ministry. Please watch the video.
We start a church here in Portales. We meet in houses like a year and a half. We start praying for for a building, and God gave us this building.
The majority of the people working at a dairy is Hispanic. These guys, they have no time. They work 6 days a week. Some work 12 hours a day, some work more. Just by receiving a water or a soda, they're like, whoa, what are these guys doing? And then, you know, when you build that relationship, it's like, you know, Jesus, this is what Jesus did for us. So, you know, now Jesus sends us out as servants to come speak to you and tell you the good news. And, you know, we go out, rain, snow, wind, it don't matter. We go out and we give them a drink. We give them Bible study. We pray for them, whatever they need.
We need people to talk with them because, you know, sometimes they don't want to talk with the strangers. And we start pray for them, and we start making a relationship with them. And then they open up. It's a lot of people that they need to hear the gospel, and it's hard. Because like for a week, we go like 38 or 40.
Over 40 dairies
a week.
You know, there's plenty of need all over New Mexico, not just here in eastern New Mexico. It's everywhere. It's amazing to be able to go out and give people hope and, you know, plant some seeds. The most important thing is the gospel's being preached, the gospel's, you know, is being proclaimed, and there's a lot of people that react to it, and, you know, everything's for the glory of God.
Fast and free, if you be.
Would you pray with me? Gracious Heavenly Father, we do come to worship you. We seek you. We cry out to you. Father, we want to lift up your name and exalt your name and magnify your name. Father, in all that we do, we want to reflect your goodness. We want to represent you well. And Father, we ask in the next few minutes that you would come and you would speak to us and help us along that journey. Guide us. Father, we need you. We pray this in the sweet name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. Hadn't it been a great morning so far? All right, all three of us are having a great morning. I hope the rest of you catch up soon, or it'll all be over before you know it. And by the way, Jesus is coming soon. Amen. Amen. This morning, the takeaway is this. To pursue God's harvest, saints must see and feel like Jesus saw and felt. I preached something like this last Sunday afternoon at the Western Association annual meeting, and this is not the exact same message, but I just felt like I needed to bring it and share this with you. Guys, it so touched my heart, this whole idea of seeing and feeling like Jesus. So you'll need to turn to Matthew chapter 9. I want us to read together verses 35 through 38. And when you find that, now that you've gotten all settled, would you stand with me in honor of the reading of God's word? Matthew chapter 9, verses 35 through 38. Jesus was going through all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom and healing every kind of disease and every kind of sickness. Seeing the people, he felt compassion for them because they were distressed and dispirited like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Therefore, beseech the Lord of the harvest to send out workers into his harvest." May God add his blessing to the reading of his powerful, anointed word. Please be seated. We're going to focus on verse 36, and that's what I've titled the message, Seeing and Feeling Like Jesus. And there's a story that I shared. I only have record that I shared it in this service. I don't have record that I ever shared it in the later service. I don't even know when it was. I just keep a note of when I share this story. Guys, this is a story that has rocked my life, and I learn more and more through it. There are little pieces of it that God helps me see certain things. I'm going to share it with you again, and if you recognize it, I just pray that you would have as much fun going through it again as I'm going to have going through it again, because it's an amazing part of my life. Long ago, I lived in West Palm Beach, Florida. Now, West Palm Beach, Florida is very much like New Mexico. They have lots of sand. It's just they also have ocean. Amen? So it's different in that way. And my son and I, when he was very small, he was less than 3 feet tall. My son and I were taking a walk on Palm Beach along Flagler Drive, right along the ocean. My description is like this. My son and I were having a wonderful walk along the seawall. It was beautiful. Palm Beach is a beautiful place. It's lavish. It's green. It's amazing. And then you look to the other side, and there's the ocean, which is more lavish and more beautiful than all the money the people on Palm Beach could ever reproduce. And I was looking at that, and it was just amazing to me. And I'm walking along Flagler Drive holding my son's hand, and my son's experience is this. There's Flagler Drive, and cars are going by. And there's a curb, and there's a little strip of grass. And there is a sidewalk that's about 3 feet wide. And there's another strip of grass, and there is a brick wall. And that brick wall is about 3 feet tall. And my son is not taking a walk beside the ocean. He's walking along Flagler Drive with his father between buildings on that side of the street and a wall on that side. That's what my son is doing. You see the difference between the experience of the father and the experience of the son in the exact same place? Guys, that's happening in this passage. Jesus is having one experience, and his followers are having a different experience. My story goes on. So something out there on the ocean caught my eye. It's amazing to stand and watch the ocean there. You're really close to the Gulf Stream, and when you get out into the Gulf Stream, the waves are huge, even on a calm day. And you can stand there, and you can watch, and you can see on the horizon these huge waves rise and fall. And I don't know what was out there, but something had caught my eye, and I had paused along Flagler Drive, and I was staring out there into the ocean, looking at what it was. But for my son, Dad just stopped. And he turned and he faced the wall and he looked above it. And he just stood there transfixed. And so my son began to pull on my pants. He began to pull on my pants. I didn't even know I'd let go of him. He was pulling on my pants. And I finally realized there was somebody down here talking and pulling on my pants. And I looked down at my little son. And his arms went up to me. And he said, "Daddy! Daddy, what'd you see? Pick me up, Daddy. Pick me up, Daddy. What'd you see? Daddy, pick me up. What'd you see?" Because my son believed that his father saw something, and he wanted to see that. And he believed that if he could get his father's attention, his father would pick him up and hold him where he was looking from. And if he could get his father to do that, then he could see what his father saw. And right at that moment, I had one of those Holy Spirit experience where the Spirit poked me and said, that is what I want you to be like with me. And guys, that's affected the way I worship. It's affected so many things about my walk with God. And a couple of weeks ago, God taught me something new, and it was from this passage, because Jesus sees the people. He sees the people, and he has to turn around to his disciples and tell them what to do, because they don't see what he sees. And I tell you this, to pursue God's harvest, God's saints must see and feel like Jesus saw and felt that day. Guys, we're never going to pray the prayer that he says here we should pray until we see like he sees and feel like he sees. My son noticed that I saw something. He believed if I would pick him up, he could see it too. He wanted to see what his father saw. And he began to cry out and call out to his father to pick him up so he could see. And guys, there's something there for us this morning. There's something in this passage that we need to pay attention to. And I want you to focus in on verse 36. It says, seeing the people. He had been going through village after village after village and teaching and healing. He's seen sick people. He's seen well people. He's seen sincere spiritual people. He's seen fake spiritual people. He's seen good people. He's seen wicked, evil people. He's seen people that the devil's leaving alone. He's seen people that the devil has sent demons to live inside of them and possessed them and taken control of them. And he's been healing and setting free and teaching and telling the gospel. Isn't that wonderful? And in the midst of all of that, he saw the people. And this is not a huge, deep word here. Seeing the people, it simply means that he noticed the people. He noticed the people. Let me ask you a question. In the last 2 days, how many people have been around you and the places that you've gone? Did you notice them? Did you notice them? Yesterday, it took me 4.5 hours to drive the 2 hours to get here. I spent a long time sitting on the interstate. And when I got here, I realized that I spent all this time with all of those people, and I never noticed the lost people around me. Does that happen to you? When you pull up to a stoplight, do you notice the people around you? When you go to the grocery store, do you notice the people around you? When you go to the workplace, do you notice the people around you? Do you see them like Jesus saw? Well, Jesus saw all those people. He noticed them. He took note of that. They existed to him. We can go through day after day after day, and people can be all around us. And guys, the truth is they don't exist to us. We don't pay any attention to them. And we must see like Jesus saw. It's a simple word. But I love the next word. It's one of my favorite words in the whole Bible. He felt compassion for them. Guys, you got to try this out. If you go out to eat this afternoon, you try this on the server. Hey, I learned a new word today. It has too many consonants all lined up together. Are you ready for it? Splognisthes. Isn't that a great word? I actually, when my son was really young and he wasn't talking yet, I thought how great it would be because I had studied Greek. And I love this word. And I thought, wouldn't it be great if the first word my son could say was splognisthes? Hey, it wasn't, guys. It was just too much for him. But I remember that. And this word splognisthes turns into a verb. And it's splognismi. Isn't that crazy? People actually speak like that. And they listen to English and think, aren't those people crazy? They actually speak like that. And this is normal to them. It's a word that described your inner organs. It described your guts. It described all the pieces that are inside of you. And back then, they believed that part of your body was the seed of your compassion and your feeling. Kind of like we use the word heart for our emotions. They used splognisthes to describe that. It describes when they use it to talk about feeling compassion, a deep feeling, a rousing concern that makes you do something. It leads to action. The noun is a concept of compassion. But when you turn it into a verb, which is what is here, it's the experience of compassion. And listen, guys, we've got to get to where compassion is not a concept that we talk about, but we see lost people, and compassion is an experience that we go to because we see them like Jesus sees them. It's interesting how this is used. It's used 12 times in the Bible. In 10 different accounts in the New Testament. All 10 of these accounts relate to to Jesus and his experience of rousing concerns. Listen, it's used 12 times in 10 different stories by three writers. It's all the same word, and it's all related to Jesus. And I look at that, and all I can think is that Jesus wants us to feel inside how he felt about people. What do you think? Say amen. Say yes. We should feel that way. Jesus wants us to feel inside how he felt about people inside. I want to show you these 10 accounts. This is amazing because I want you to see something. In Mark chapter 1, the scripture says that Jesus is moved with compassion. A leper has come up to him and asked what he wants. And he says, if you're willing, I want to see. And it says that he beseeched Jesus. He cried out to Jesus and he fell on his knees. He said, if you are willing. And then Jesus, Listen to this. That man with leprosy, who no one would touch or come near, Jesus walked up and he touched him. And that leprosy left him. It went away. It was gone. Isn't that amazing? That man was cleansed by Jesus that day. And that's what happens when Jesus feels compassion. In Luke chapter 7, it's another story that's told about Jesus where he felt compassion. He was walking with some of his disciples. It says it was a crowd. And he was approaching the little village of Nain. And out of the village of Nain was coming a crowd because a mother, a widow, was coming out with her dead son being carried by several people on their shoulders on a pier behind her. And they were coming out and she was weeping. And he sees her. He sees this mother with a dead son, and he feels compassion. And I want you to know, when Jesus feels compassion, he's about to do something. He's about to do something, and he walks up. He walks up, and he speaks to this dead son, and he raises up her dead son, and it says this, that he gave him back to her. Amen. I mean, when Jesus feels compassion, guys, something's going to happen. In Matthew 14, there's another story about Jesus and feeling compassion. As a matter of fact, he saw people and he said they looked like they were sheep without a shepherd. And he healed their sick. He healed their sick. He did miracle after miracle after miracle. And then he looked at them and they thought they were hungry. And so he decided to feed them. And he takes a lad's little lunch of 5 loaves and 2 fish. And he feeds over 5,000 people. Guys, when Jesus feels compassion, something about his power is fixing to be poured out. And he's about to do something. In Matthew 15, it happened again. And Jesus saw people and he said that they looked like sheep without a shepherd. And he felt compassion for them, and he healed their sick, and once again he took 7 loaves and a few fish and he fed them, and that time he fed 4,000 people. Isn't that amazing? And that follows Jesus feeling compassion. There's one passage, it's a request of Jesus. It's a father who comes to him, and his son has been taken over by a demon. And he comes to Jesus and he says this, because it's as if he knows that if Jesus feels compassion, something amazing is going to happen. And he says, "Oh, Jesus, have compassion on us." And Jesus does, and he casts out that spirit from that boy. And everybody thinks the boy is dead. And he takes the boy's hand, and he lifts him up, and he gives him back to that father. That's what Jesus does when he feels compassion. Amen? Oh, but that's not all. There's 3 parables that Jesus tells. And when Jesus talks about feeling compassion, it's just like when he feels compassion, something's about to happen. And the first parable, it's the parable of the generous master. A slave comes and pleads, and the master's saying, "You need to repay this great debt," and there's no way he can. And he pleads and he begs of that master. And that master forgives all of his debt. All of it. Amen. Not one, it's a picture of forgiveness. And when Jesus describes feeling compassion, something amazing is going to happen. And in the parable of the Good Samaritan, the Samaritan comes along and sees a man from Jerusalem who to him would be a despicable person. He sees him laying there beaten up. And that Samaritan, Jesus says, felt compassion on him. Warning, warning, wait for something amazing to happen. And that Samaritan walks over to that man from Jerusalem after he sees him and feels compassion. And he touches him. He touches him. He doesn't just touch a person. He touches a wounded person, a bleeding person. He touches his wounds and bandages his wounds. Then he picks him up and he carries him to an inn and he continues to care for him. And when he can't care for him there anymore, he pays the innkeeper to take care of him until he comes back. And he goes on his way until he can return. Guys, that's amazing. That's amazing. That's someone who feels compassion. In Luke 15, it's the parable of the forgiving father. You know the story is the prodigal son. This father, after his son has left and taken his portion of the inheritance and he's squandered it, and he's lived a terrible life. He's coming back to his father, knowing he's unworthy to come back to the home, but he hopes that maybe his father will take him back as a slave. And from a long way off, the Bible says, that father saw him. Are you feeling the tremble? He saw him, and it says he felt compassion for him. Spoiler alert, something amazing is about to happen. And the son who had left and had squandered everything and who had lived a terrible life and violated everything his father stood for, that father from a long way off, he began to run. And he ran toward his son, and he got to his son, and his son started to fall on his knees, and he throws his arms around his son, and he hugs his son, and he says, "Bring the finest clothes and robes and clothe my son." And then he says, "We'll celebrate. Kill the fatted calf." And he says this, "For my son was dead and now he is alive. My son was lost and now he is found." Guys, that's amazing. And that's what happens when somebody feels compassion. And there's another story. It's in Matthew 20. It's a story about two blind men who come up to Jesus. And it says they called out. They cried out. They probably said, "Daddy, Daddy," and pulled on him. They cried out to him. And Jesus called them and says, "Come close." And he says, "What do you want?" He knew what they wanted. But he asked them, "What do you want?" And they said, "We want to see." And Jesus felt compassion for them. And you know what happens when Jesus feels compassion for somebody? Have you caught it yet? When Jesus feels compassion on somebody, something amazing is about to happen. Something amazing. And Jesus touched their eyes. And they regained their sight. They could see. Can you imagine that? That's the kind of thing that happens when Jesus feels compassion. But there's one odd verse, one odd use, one very unusual use of Jesus feeling compassion. And we know that when Jesus feels compassion, the next thing he does is something wonderful and amazing, and his power is poured out. Amen. But this one passage is very odd. Because if that's true, that means what Jesus asks his people to do is something through which he wants to pour out his power and do something amazing. And that verse is found in Matthew chapter 9 and verse 36. And Jesus, seeing the people, feels compassion for them. Do you feel the ground begin to rumble? Something amazing is about to happen. He sees them and he feels compassion because they were distressed and dispirited like sheep without a shepherd. Now listen to this. Here is the miracle. Here is the incredible thing that he does. Here is something absolutely amazing. He said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Therefore, beseech the Lord of the harvest to send out workers into the harvest." I have encountered so many saints who've lost hope in that passage. But I want you to know, that passage comes after Jesus feeling compassion. And when Jesus asked his people to pray to the Lord of the harvest, to send out workers into the harvest, I want you to know, I've read the Bible. I've read when Jesus feels compassion. I've told you about it. And I know with all my heart that when Jesus gave that command, something amazing was about to happen. Don't you believe it? Don't you believe it? And that command is there for us today to pray and beseech the Lord of the harvest to send out workers into harvest. Oh, but I warn you, I've not only read this passage, I kept on reading. Because right after he told them to pray that God would send out workers into the harvest, I warn you, God is about to do something great. And if you engage in this prayer, you engage in the outpouring of the power of the Lord God Almighty here on the earth for his purposes and his purposes alone, not for yours. And the next chapter, the very next verses, Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal every kind of disease and every kind of sickness. And he names them and he sends them out and he instructs them to preach the gospel everywhere they go. And he sends them out into the villages, not their own villages, but other villages. And while they go to other villages, Jesus goes to their villages. That's what the Bible says. And guys, if you read the story, it's amazing what God does through these men as they go out and they preach. Listen, if you listen to Matthew chapter 36 and you pray this prayer, you are entering into something where God wants to pour out His power. God wants to do something amazing. But if you pray this prayer, listen, I want you to hear this. If you pray this prayer, you have to be ready to go. You have to be ready for Jesus to call you and to put His power upon you and to put His message upon you and to send you out with an assignment. Do you hear me? Do you hear me? Listen, every time Jesus saw the people and felt compassion, He was about to do something absolutely amazing. And in this passage, He doesn't leave it just He and that person alone. He doesn't keep it all to Himself. In this passage, He invites His people, you and me, into His work with Him. And He says, pray. Will you do that? Will you do that? My son, years ago, he pulled on my pants because he felt like he believed that I saw something and he wanted to see what I saw. And so he pulled on my pants and got my attention. Do you want to see what Jesus saw? Church, listen to me. Do you want to see what Jesus saw? Do you want God to pour out His power in this place? I walked around this morning and I was walking through rooms praying. And I walked through six rooms that are storerooms or rooms filled with stuff that could be Bible study rooms. That's what they were built for. And we've gotten used to them being storage places for things that we never touch or use. Are we ready? Do we want to see what Jesus sees? We sit on a hill where you can look out and you can see a gallop all around us. When you leave today, I encourage you to pause for a moment and look around and see. And ask God to help you to feel compassion, because I have no idea where my notes are. Here they are. Let's see where we're supposed to go next, because we need to land this plane. You know, years ago, when I realized that I had trouble seeing people, I began to ask God to help me to see people. One of the things that God did was kind of amazing. The largest U.S. trailer manufacturer of enclosed trailers, I have a little enclosed trailer. I'm pulling it today to Farmington, filled with equipment for the BCM's annual meeting. And I'm kind of into little trailers. And the largest manufacturer, just trivia for you, of small enclosed trailers is a company called Look. They're all over Albuquerque where I live. And I'll be sitting at a stoplight, minding my own business, not seeing anybody. And I will look up, and there parked beside me will be a trailer. And their logo is the word look, and the two O's are two tires that look like eyeballs looking back at you. And every time I see that, I hear God saying to me, look and see the people. See the people around you. You'll never feel compassion if you don't see. You'll never feel that. You'll never pray that prayer like Jesus wants you to pray it until you see people and you feel compassion for them like He did. That trailer, those trailers remind me to see lost people, to look around, to have spiritual curiosity and concern. So what do we do? Guys, we need a plan for action. Amen? I've put in your notes in the bulletin a list of words, and you need to ask God to help you. You need to tug on Him, and you need to put your arms up. Maybe you need to do that. That's how the Jews would pray. I don't think they realized what they were really doing, but they held their hands up to pray. Maybe you need to reach up like you're reaching up to Daddy. And you need to say, Daddy, Daddy, pick me up, Daddy, pick me up, Daddy. As you look at these things, at this list, you need to see lost people as part of our action plan. And when you see lost people, you need to interact with them for a kingdom purpose. And when you're interacting with them for a kingdom purpose, you need to engage them in spiritual conversations. I didn't give you all these phrases. You ought to be writing them down. See lost people, interact with them for a kingdom purpose, engage them in spiritual conversation, and then you do what we teach in evangelism class. You tell them God's story. And then you invite them to follow Jesus. And then you bring them to God's people. Amen? But we're not done yet, because the Bible says that now we need to teach them to obey all that He has commanded us. And so this is the plan of action right here. See lost people. Interact with them for a kingdom purpose. Engage them in spiritual conversation. Tell them God's story. Invite them to follow Jesus. Bring them to God's people. Teach them to obey all Jesus commanded. Can you do it? Maybe get on your knees so you'll be about the height of my son. And put your hands up and just cry out, Daddy! Daddy, what you see, Daddy? Daddy, what you see? Pick me up, Daddy. Pick me up, Daddy.